I know what I'm talking about. Is that okay? People bothering you? No. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, good. Here we go. Okay, the Steiner page. This is not, this can't be found in any Steiner book. I just pulled pieces of information from many, many lectures and tried to organize it, partly so that I could remember it, and partly because I wanted to see if it made sense as a total picture. I think it is much, much, much too literal. I mean, it couldn't hold up. You wouldn't ever take this into a, you know, a social science course at Stanford. I say that knowingly. My brother is a PhD Stanford and a professor at Stanford, and he would just, his eyes would just roll back. He's another brother, by the way. But this is a really nice brother. Who would just sort of say, "Robert, please don't take this in public." on the other hand, he likes all those schools. So, you know, life is complicated and interesting. Here's what's here. Steiner thinks that a human being develops according to the quality or the mode of consciousness of large periods in the past. So from birth to seven, we have a consciousness like a sort of, it's primal. It's everything is united, and it is not affected by the experience of loss or alienation at all, even though Freud thinks that it was. Steiner thinks it isn't. That the child has a sensory life which is completely positive and is enabling the child to orient. I mean, like, if you watch the child stand up and fall down and stand up, and clearly the child is orienting, you know, it's more than just standing up and falling down. It's the child is orienting to the cosmos. It's an amazing accomplishment from, you know, great act of will, all right, or speaking, right? How they try out words and then phrases and then sentences, and then they speak a sentence that has never been spoken before. It's and it makes sense. It's an amazing accomplishment. Right. So Steiner said all of that is in the whole psychic world or spiritual world. All right. So, and then at, he says from seven to 13 is what he calls, not the India that we know of the Upanishads, even much, much, much earlier than that. He thinks that there was an island in the Atlantic that was very moist, I mean extremely moist, and it basically dissolved in the water without a trace. So it didn't so much sink where you could find it, it just went down. I have no idea whether this could be true, but almost nobody else agrees to it. And I've looked, I have three or four books on Atlantis. I have no idea what to do about it. I don't say it in public. Sorry?
Who's that? Philos, the Thebian, or something like that? The guy, the entity that, like, transcribed the Atlantean saga through some guy.
What's his name?
Some guy was like, Philos, the Thebian, or something like that.
Not Philo Judaeus.
His books of this entity, this, like, Atlantean entity who transmitted the whole story of what it's like to
yeah.
be a guy in Atlantis.
Yeah, yeah.
Guy in Mount
Shasta.
Yeah.
Sounds like Mount Shasta.
Don't know. I have three or four books.
Could
I have
Robert?
No idea. Plato definitely believed in Atlantis.
Philo
who?
Philo of Alexandria. And
really?
Timaeus of Plato.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Timaeus
yeah.
is the only primary source that mentions Atlantis.
Right, yeah. Plato definitely was convinced of the but that could be just mythic stuff that he inherited.
I got it in the Theosophical Library.
Okay.
That's
Yes, well, Blavatsky was first name basis with Atlantis. All right. I don't know what to do with that. We are friends, so I kept it on. I could have deleted it. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I just don't know. But then he says there was an ancient Indian civilization which was predated by millennia, the Indian civilization that we know, of the Vedas and the Upanishads, and then there was the Persian, and then there was then we get into history, the Egypto-Hebraic, well, we actually know a lot, and more and more, right? And then the Greco-Roman Christian. But notice, this is all Western. This doesn't say anything about Harappa or Mohenjo-Daro or the Zhou dynasty or none of that. Well, that's inadequate. So it all would have to be done again. I don't know. I mean, if somebody said you have a 5-year sabbatical to write a book on the evolution of consciousness, I don't know that it's worth doing. It might just be, well, we're going to get to this, whether it's a helpful idea. It could be, and it could be that it's just too damaging. It's just too sort of controversial, kind of polluted almost. Right? So anyway, now, this could be interesting. Since the 15th century, and everybody in this program is aware of the 15th century, right? Rick is always talking about the Copernican Revolution, the 15th century. And he knows that stuff inside out from Thomas Kuhn and Taylor and etc. And that's the book that Villa was writing when he died. So this is tremendously important. Steiner said, "I'll tell you how important it is that it was a change in consciousness as important as the change in consciousness at." The 7th century BC, all right, which is what called Jaspers, you know this book, J-A-S-P-E-R-S, refers to as the Axial Age, the age when the foundations for not Christianity and Islam, but for Greek thought, Hebraic consciousness, Chinese, Confucius loves a Indian Bhagavad Buddha and Bhagavad Gita and Mahavira, Persian world, Zoroaster, etc. All of that happened because of a coherent change of consciousness. And I think this is pretty important. I believe that in terms of loss of consciousness, those traditions, those new paradigms came about because of the loss of unity that those traditions tried to recover. Am I making sense? In other words, the awareness of the divine was receding. And these religions are the response to the reconnect. All right. So you don't need those religions if you've got the divine in your heart and mind and it's all around. You need it if it's receding, all right, and you're not so sure, and the people in charge of your culture are not so sure. So that happened around the 7th century, beginning of Greek philosophy, and all these other explosions of genius, all right. Then he says the next one was the 15th century, when there was a change in unwanted people. A change in consciousness which made possible an entirely different paradigm of tremendous complexity and a unity that comes from human thinking. Not now believing, but thinking. And that's why this whole period that genius period, 15th to the 19th century, right to the present time, is a scientific time because it comes from philosophy and science, namely, so thinking. And so if you want the documents for this, one of the best is Pico della Mirandola, the oration on the dignity of, he calls it man, what would we do, the human, dignity of human beings. It's not human beings, it's humanity. All right, Pico della Mirandola, where he says that there's the divine realm and there's the earthly realm, and the human not only bridges, but determines the level at which it will live and think. It's a very powerful, it's a short, it's an oration, it's a speech. And basically, he announces the Renaissance, that from now on, the human is the center of the world. Physically, there's another center, but the human is the center of the relationship between the divine and the earth. It's an amazing document. And another place to read this that is very, very clear, I mean, our next book is clear, but the one that sticks in my head this minute, I shouldn't say but, and the one that sticks in my head this minute, is Ernst Cassirer, C-A-S-S-I-R-E-R, who has many, many wonderful books on Kant, on the Enlightenment, on all kinds of things. He has a book called The Individual and the Cosmos in Renaissance Philosophy, where he talks about Nicholas of Cusa, a cardinal, mathematician, scientist, an amazing figure. Jake, who you don't yet know, but you will, is an expert on Cusa. All right, so that 15th century is crucial, and Steiner says that is the culture that we are in, that we will be in, we in the West. Doesn't really know that much about other modes of thinking. Really only knows the West. In fact, he only knows Europe. And he says that this consciousness that we are in is getting harder and harder, smarter and harder, all right? That more and more materialistic, more and more pluralistic in an alienating way, not pluralistic at an exciting all the different colors of the rainbow. No, no, no. It's alienating as pulled apart. And he says that the task of a culture, a consciousness that is increasingly pluralistic or increasingly losing connection to the divine is to restore it by human thinking. Just as we've gotten smarter in our knowledge of science and philosophy and all kinds of things, and sailing around the world and now flying around the world, okay, we now have to be exercise free moral individual thinking, not group thinking, individual thinking. So it's actually the same as Emerson, all right? Because it's a very short line from Emerson to Steiner, except Steiner did more, but it was the same idea. All right, now, what else? Then he says that there's a soul mood for each of these periods, sentient soul, and that's a pretty good word. Intellectual soul, I guess, is pretty good if you think of the Greeks as the primary ones. Then it's not so clear what he should call the next one. He calls it spiritual soul, but for consciousness soul, well, that's by which he means we're now conscious of consciousness. I don't know. What else could he call it? I think he could call it self-conscious soul. He might call it individualized soul, except that we're also, as somebody said, more and more failing in individuality. Who said that? Somebody before, early on. Okay, so I don't know what you want to do with the sheet, but it could be a guide of one way to deal with some of what he had to say. But he has so much to say about everything, you'd have to have a lot of sheets to actually get them straight. Okay, now, hierarchy of consciousness. And in Aurobindo and Steiner, it's very clear that it has always been the case that there are individuals who are gifted and who are leaders and who pave the way for the next age or who give the information for the next big solution or whatever. It is an anti-democratic position. It's very controversial. I don't know if you want to spend time with it. I does see, in fact, in this book that I just read, this chapter that I wrote last, but anyway, it doesn't matter. But anyway, I read it. And it starts off by saying, why is it that we, as a culture, do not grant that there are some people with superior ways of knowing when A, we know better, and secondly, we don't have any trouble with, say, Leonardo, Michelangelo, Raphael as incredible Renaissance painters, or Bach, Mozart, Beethoven, Mahler, etc., as these incredible musical geniuses. But we seem to have trouble with anybody knowing something that sort of you're not supposed to know. That's sort of too deep, too secret, too something. It's a very interesting situation, and I know we have it, but I don't know. Anyway, Steiner seems to be a person like, you know, Swedenborg and Blavatsky and Aurobindo and some others who seem to have this capacity to know what not only most of us don't know, but most of us are convinced it's not possible to know. So right away you're plunged into a certain amount of controversy. It's kind of interesting that I'm in this business because I'm quite a passionate small d Democrat, and a big D Democrat too, but a small d Democrat in the sense that I really care a lot about democratic values. And I know, I mean, I'm a Deweyite actually. I'm very devoted to Dewey. So it's an interesting problem that I live with. And I think that they just, somehow we have to work it out so that we can have both, you know, the absolute best of human rights and human opportunity and say in the legal realm, and at the same time have freedom and a variety of capacity in the cultural realm. I'm okay with that if it were observed, but it's it's not so well. It's hard to implement that because lots of people with a special ability then appropriate privileges. I mean, where Steiner was a servant, he didn't really appropriate privileges. Did Aurobindo? I don't know what I'd say about that. He was in his room for 40 years, and I don't think he did the dishes. I don't know, it's a hard question, Aurobindo. Teilhard was just an absolutely gorgeous human being. Absolutely, a really, really saintly person.
Plato was anti-democratic too, right?
Sorry?
Plato was anti-democratic too, right?
Plato was fiercely anti-democratic. Absolutely. He said it's every time that a city opts for democracy, it leads to chaos, and then it goes to tyranny. Yeah. No, he was an absolute... In fact, there's two big fat volumes called The Open Society and Its Enemies. Written by Karl Popper against Plato and Hegel. No, Marx. Sorry. It's Hegel and Marx as being anti-democratic. It's not a good reading of Plato, but Plato gives lots of good texts for a critique. Yeah. I don't find Steiner violating anybody's rights. But he does say that some people have access and other people don't, and I just think that seems to be true. Brian?
Well, I mean, he does have an attitude that this is the way you can get this enlightenment.
Yeah.
And if you don't have it, then you're not doing it correctly.
He thinks he's given very helpful advice on how to get deeper knowledge.
So he tells somebody how to do it right, so that's why I think, you know, when you're talking about somebody telling you what is the truth as far as ultimate reality is concerned,
right,
there is such a antipathy to that, I think, since the decline of the Catholic Church 500 or 600 years ago, when they burned Giordano Bruno at the stake for what he believed. And there is such an antipathy to that, that if anybody, even if they're saints, it's like, okay, that's fine, but I'm still have my own view. It's like an independent freedom.
I couldn't agree more, but in the case of Steiner, he did not give any advice to anybody who didn't ask for it. No, he did not impose his will on anybody, in any respect.
But he wouldn't acknowledge that they, like, have tolerance for their views, would he?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I thought he had the correct way.
I don't find any intolerance in him. He has a lack of knowledge about Asia. He doesn't have any intolerance. I haven't found any. I'd be upset if I did.
Okay, pretty much in the beginning of every one of his, like, papers and books, he says, question me, like,
yeah.
I'm probably wrong about this. Like, right. Or he doesn't go that far.
He says, I'm probably wrong. He says, this is my view at this time. I may have to change it, and you may find differently, and I hope you join in the effort. He's really clear about that. He is intensely devoted to individuality and freedom. Yeah. Yeah, David?
He does all... maybe this is slightly different, but he does have this inconvenient drawing. I don't know if he did it, of the hierarchy of race.
He has his stuff on... He has about 12 pages that are very embarrassing.
Yeah.
And... were wrong even when he did them in 1920.
Right. Yeah.
Right. I mean, my brother's an anthropologist, so I brought him. I said, how bad is this? He said, really bad. I said, but was it really bad in 1920? And he said, yeah, it was really bad in 1920. Right.
Yeah.
So there are, but only about 12 pages out of 350 volumes.
Yeah.
But still, it's embarrassing because
he's
supposed to get it all right. Well, I never thought he got it all right.
Yeah.
I never thought anybody got it all right, so I'm not upset about it in that sense. I'm upset that it's something important to us, and he should have gotten it right. It would have helped a lot.
Totally, yeah.
Yeah. I think he's good on gender, but not good on race. Right. And the Jewish question, which is really hot, needless to say, as a person who lived in Central Europe, not through the Second World War, but through the First, he had Jewish friends, he had great affection for Jewish culture, etc. But he really did think that the spiritual mission of the Jewish people was pre-Christian, which I think is a wrong view, and a very unfortunate, unacceptable view. But he held that view, so he didn't get it all right, absolutely not. I'm going to keep going. Teleological. This whole evolution of consciousness view is teleological. That's the difference between evolution of consciousness and history. History could just be a bunch of events. And just this happened, then that happened. And who knows why? We still haven't figured out the First World War. Figured out the Second World War. Well, actually, that was still changing that as well. But the First World War is really confusing. All right, there's lots of literature on the Civil War. All right. But the evolution of consciousness says it is aiming for something far off that's like a success of some kind, all right? And Aurobindo says it's the creation of the divine life on earth. Same with Augustine. The city of God is the creation of divinity on earth. Steiner thinks it's aiming at freedom and love, not obedience, not conformity, freedom and love. And Teilhard has this idea of the omega point. I think actually you should call it the omega phase rather than point. It's not so like that. But he definitely believes that the earth and Christ will be experienced as a unity in the fulfillment of history. Lots of people are not too excited about that. this is a minority. Whichever version you take, it's minority. And unfortunately, they don't agree that much. Well, they do to some extent, but not the same. They certainly don't use the same language. All right, so we're in trouble. Okay. And as I said five times, I mean, look, I wrote a doctoral dissertation on Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan. So I mean, I've been involved with, and I've been teaching Gandhi, for 50 years. So I care a lot about certainly India, but also Buddha and Buddhism and classical Chinese. I don't know the history of China so well, but I do know a good bit about Confucianism and Taoism. So I really care about that, and I'm very conscious that in the evolution of consciousness in Hegel, and Steiner, it's not there. So it's a hopelessly inadequate view. So teleology could still be true, but it could be that only a part of the story has been told. And it would have to be told very differently because it's based on what happened in the 15th century West. Well, actually, what happened in the 15th century West is now happening everywhere. So it is the dominant paradigm, not just economically, but intellectually. Big interesting situation. All right, is it anthropocentric? Well, okay. Oh, I've been in this argument so many times. Okay. Many of the paradigms that are critiqued for being anthropocentric, I believe, are not. Not because of some really good reason that a reason that the critics would like, but for another reason, namely, say, Christianity is accused of being anthropocentric. It's actually divine-centric. It's not anthropocentric. It's primarily centric on the return to the creation from the divine and the return to the divine. That's the centric, Brian.
Well, but that's just for humans.
Yeah,
it's just for humans.
Yeah.
Centered what about the plants, animals, the earth, the rocks?
Okay.
Come on, the rocks. The mountains. The rocks.
Yeah. Now. So I don't know if anthropocentric is the right word for that. It is not sufficiently earth-centric. That's for sure. So if anthropocentric is in contrast to earth-centric or human and earth, then that's fine. But it's not that some positions that are accused of being anthropocentric are devoted to a larger context. Now, with respect to the earth, who is earth-centric? I think really only the shamanic traditions until very, very recently. None of the major paradigms from post-shamanic to the present are primarily earth-centric. Earth-centric is a correction of all of the paradigms of the last 2 or 3 millennia. And so if you go through the big books that Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Wim produced on religion and ecology, which does Judaism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Buddhism, Taoism, Confucianism, and Shamanism, the only one that is uniform in its affirmation of the earth is the shamanic. All the others are a mix and barely 50% positive with respect to the affirmation of the earth. There are good passages and really bad passages in every tradition. Not only that, there are really bad passages in modern Western, primarily materialistic science, as for example, in Bacon, in Descartes. These are not people who love the earth, they love the mind. They privilege the mind, not the earth. And Descartes, you know, said that animals didn't have any feeling. So, I mean, it's not that religions made this mess, it's that modern science is just as anti-Earth and anti-non-human species. It's not a good story, even at the present time. But there is now the beginning of a worldwide improvement or reaction. But it's not as though there's one villain. As far as I can tell, all of the thought traditions have been about equally discrediting of the non-human world. Some in favor of a divinity, and some in favor of just military accomplishment or capitalism or something else. I mean, the capitalists, you know, they're not even pro-human in some respects. They're pro-profit. This is not the same. It's in favor of some small number of humans, but not all humans. So, Brian?
Well, I was just going to say, the earth-centric, I mean, from anthropocentric human to the earth-centric, I would actually extend it to cosmos. I mean,
say what?
To the cosmos. It's the universe-centric.
Yeah, right. That's absolutely a new conception.
Even the earth-centric is like anthropomorphic. I mean, It's way beyond the earth.
Right, I agree. Now there,
to the
case,
fourth.
Well, I was slow to see this when I started out with Steiner, but actually Steiner is, has a huge attention to the evolution and the meaning of the cosmos.
Yeah, I saw he brought in Saturn.
Big time, and
the moon.
big, yeah. You know, I brought it to Brian and Rick, they were pretty excited. It was, wow, I didn't know he said that. So the role of planets on daily life, right? And not too many people are able to be affirmative of all the parts. They are in a little bit of competition, and it's hard to sustain a positive view of all the parts, but some people do a whole lot better than others. And I mean, I think this program, frankly, has that as one of its really great strengths, is that it is trying to hold together all the parts, the cosmos, the earth, the non-human, the human, the historical, the something, if not transcendent, then deep, etc. I think it's quite impressive in that regard. Yeah. And I myself have made, I think, very significant improvements in my thinking by being here, and I hope that you do as well. Okay, I'm going to keep going.
Buddhism earth-centric?
Sorry?
Isn't Buddhism earth-centric?
Buddhism is not earth-centric.
Like all beings are...
That's a good comment. I believe the core of Buddhism is to enable the human being to overcome attachment to self. That is the core teaching. All the Buddhists agree to that. Now, even beyond Mahayana to Vajrayana to Tibetan Buddhism, the Dalai Lama says, I will return to earth while there's still a suffering, sentient being, all right? But that is not a replacement for the more fundamental Buddhist teaching and practice, which is to overcome attachment to self. I'm pretty sure about this. Yes?
I'm reflecting, on that, what you just said, but the behavioral consequences of that is quite earth-centric. Because the way you behave, your choice of your lifestyle.
Totally.
Be, yeah.
And that's true of all the religions. So Christianity teaches love. If you're a loving person, you should love the earth, unless you have an idea that prevents you. All right, so Francis loved the earth, but Augustine had an idea that he got from Plato that said the earth wasn't important. So he didn't love the earth. So yes, if really loving should lead to loving everything, but some ideas get in the way. Alex?
That's really interesting, I think. I think there's a tension between like having faith that we're going to a new place and like acting when you see something happening that's wrong. So if you see like, oh, what's happening now with everyone moving towards like consumerism is eventually gonna be a good thing. That's like a kind of faith that we're going to a good place. But then there's also this tension of like, it's not a good thing, people are suffering, let me do something about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's happening doesn't mean that it's an expression of some deep wisdom of the universe. Could happen despite the wisdom of the universe. But that's what we're supposed to be finding out. What is the deep wisdom and what is the distortion of the wisdom? Which we're working on that. That's why we're here, actually. Glad you came. Hope you're ready to help out.
I've got a question.
Go ahead.
To not have a basis in what you're talking about exactly, but you said that Confucianism and Taoism aren't centered on the earth, and I don't know much about what they say, but I know that they came out of the I Ching. And with the I Ching, a third of each hexagram has a place for the earth, and then it's the combination of that with man and the heaven that give it a basis for considering change.
Yeah.
And then that, in turn, I think, was the basis for how those religions came about. So how could they have lost the centricness of the earth?
They very briefly, the way I think about Confucianism and Taoism. The Tao, I still write T sometimes. The Tao, all right, is involved with the natural world and the human world. And the human and nature are entwined. And the Taoist and the Confucian only differ. They really read like the opposites. But they only differ in that the Confucian wants to develop a healthy, vibrant, enduring triangle by social means, by education and rituals and etc. And the Taoists are trying to do it internally by basically an aesthetics. But neither one is based on the earth. They include the natural world. So it's not quite true to say they come from the I Ching, that the I Ching is one of the components by which to read what is happening, how is the Tao manifesting in nature or in human experience. And if you can, it's a microcosm, macrocosm relationship, as I see it. I think I actually know that to be so.
Yeah, that's very, yeah.
Isabella didn't change what I said, so I'm gonna go ahead as though I got away with it. Bottom up. So in the way I read the evolution of consciousness, the further back you go, the more completely hierarchical it was. And at the present, in our own time, individuality is sufficiently developed and is sufficient variety, and the whole cultural realm as such is in some cases is very vigorous, that the would-be higher beings, privileged prophets and bodhisattvas and whatever else, are almost in a free-for-all for attention and influence. That is to say, they only have influence to the extent that they are acknowledged. There's no, or hardly any, pre-established authority and power coming from somebody with special ability, special knowing.
Who's stretching?
Oh, good, that's fine. So it is from now on, it is both top-down and bottom-up in a sometimes collaboration and sometimes in an intense conflict and opposition, the way I think about it. Okay, we can talk more about that if you want. So at the present time, I think that the overall trend of human consciousness is about equally positive and negative. And they're both going very fast. We, say in this community, know an amazing amount that would have been impossible 100 years ago about modes of thought, about kinds of problems, about kinds of solutions, about different kinds of peoples, about what has happened and what is happening. Amazing amount. And so that's all positive. Right? We also are conscious of other people in faraway places when catastrophe hits, wherever in the world. It doesn't show up adequately, but it shows up on our screens, on our papers, in our conversation. Some people send money, some people, one of our alums, Michael Babel, has been at every catastrophe, of the last 10 years as a rescue person. Haiti and Japan and other places. I don't know if he went to Japan, but Haiti he did a lot. Anyway, so that is all new and quite amazing. Whereas in the ancient times, people hardly knew, 100 miles away. They mostly only knew the tribe next door, which they feared. So this is incredibly different. And the media, of course, is a we can say it's the cause, it's the byproduct, but it certainly is enhancing that happening. That's the good news. The bad news is that it comes with lots of fear, lots of fear of that, people's fear that their world is changing. They're not gonna have they're being forced out of their comfort zone. This is a major motivation for lots of violence and prejudice and etc. So as I see it, we are getting more informed, more in contact. Everything is happening in a way that could be fabulously positive, and within it, there are these quite regressive, violent forces that are working against relationality and othering and preventing, and whether fighting about land or, I mean, the 19th century was fighting about oil, and the 20th century was fighting about oil. 19th century is mostly about land, but certainly the 20th century is about oil, and the 21st century, I'm pretty sure, is going to be about water. Mm-hmm. A lot of people are going to get killed or killed for water. Yeah, Brian.
Well, I was just going to say, everything that you described, it sounds like an evolution of consciousness.
I think it is an evolution of consciousness.
Hierarchy, structure, oppression, to more individuality, freedom, choices.
Right.
More tolerance, more acceptance of communities. Sounds
yes.
Like an evolution of consciousness.
But also lots and lots of opposition to the very thing that is would seem to be positive. Lots of opposition and fear, intolerance, prejudice, and just plain, actually a lot of sect violence. There's a lot of sect violence. A lot of people are not able to function.
That's all there. There's always regression, and there's
right.
People fighting against it.
Right.
But I mean, from 2,000 years ago, the hierarchy, the oppression,
right.
to now,
yep.
there's an obvious evolution.
There's some big improvements.
But there's always people fighting
slow.
Against it. There's always people fighting
yeah.
against it.
I mean, it's slavery in the New Testament. You know? You can't have slavery.
Well, there's slavery
in the
right
Book
now
of
in San Francisco.
Sorry?
There's slavery right now in San Francisco.
Yeah,
there's
2 million,
lots of women who are
2 million sex
enslaved
slaves.
In this city, yeah. Within a mile of here.
2 million where?
Throughout the world.
Say the hierarchy has become more invisible.
Right, exactly.
Right. But the good and the bad is that terrible things are happening, and that's bad. And the good thing is that we have a knowledge, we have an opposition. And we recognize that this is bad and we should change. We haven't been as able to change what at least we agree needs to be changed. I mean, it's only really 100 years, 150 years ago that the United States outlawed slavery. It's an incredible history. And racism, of course, has continued since. So, you know, if I hear somebody being optimistic about how the world is getting better, in 10 seconds, I can just totally destroy that point of view. Really, I could give, what about, yeah. And if somebody says it's all going downhill, and et cetera, well, wait a minute. We do have this organization that's watching this and watching that, and we do have all these people volunteering. And even when Ebola broke out, then, you know, Doctors Without, which must be one of the best organizations we know about. I used to think Amnesty was the best, now I think Doctors Without Borders is the best. I mean, they were there. So that's an amazing thing. So it's, and these very heroic deeds, like ecology workers, are in response to something really bad that's going on. And they do come together. Sam, okay? Mm-hmm. So faith in the evolution, but faith cuts both ways. You do need a lot of faith to get through the day, you know, and to start a program and make a relationship. And all kinds of other things. You just need faith. And you can also have faith that gets in the way of honesty and, you know, commitment to experience and openness to bad news. So everything can be misused. I have not found anything except love, real love. I mean, love can be devoted to exploitation and kind of power, hunger, etc. But if it's real love, I think it doesn't it's the one survivor. Okay, I want to just two or three more, and then you can ask anything or say anything. The psychological. I think for the psychological about the evolution of consciousness, I think Jung is our best. I think he really has the ticket for the way that we are coming to know and need to know archetypes, myths, symbols, images that are positive or negative in our culture. He that's the huge contribution. And I don't think anybody else does as well as he does on the psychology of the big picture. Uncovering the knowledge of those archetypes, myths, symbols is an amazing contribution. And if you've never looked through the Red Book, you should sit in your office, you should treat yourself. Steiner is psychological, but not at the extent and the originality of Jung. So who asked about hubris? I didn't get the question. What was it? I know it was hot.
Is the evolution of consciousness, like, kind of as a concept, as this romantic thing, is it a farce of hubris? Is it just people talking about themselves? Is it, you know,
fantasy?
The myth of progress. Yeah.
Is it like a navel gazing sort of a, we're so great, aren't we getting better kind of a thing?
That is absolutely in there.
Yeah.
No question. The question for me is not whether that's in there. That's in there big time. I said several times, this is an embarrassing idea, coming by, in the sense that, you know, so I'm not going to try to convince Dewey that this is a really good idea, all right? I also think that there's enough to it that if it were redone, not by white male, self-impressed.
I could think of another word, but
yeah. But it would be a lot of work, and I think it's not going to happen soon. It is just so huge. But one, I know a couple of things. Suppose we said, well, what would we look for sort of globally, right? I do think that the passion for human rights is an accomplishment of the evolution of consciousness, which is everywhere, even where, and maybe especially where they're not realized. That is really big. And it doesn't seem like it's going away. It's beat up, it's pushed down, and democracies are failing, but human rights does seem to be a passion.
Can I ask a follow-up question?
Huh?
Just really quick, a follow-up.
Fine, we're not in a hurry.
So you've acknowledged that there is this hubris side,
definitely.
It's just kind of calling out as if this is obvious. Name it.
Right.
So if that's kind of the shadow side,
right?
How do we deal with it? How do we move forward? How do we keep going with talking about the evolution of consciousness without feeling like we are the self-congratulators?
Right. I think that, for me, I think of a couple of parallels. So I'm very enthusiastic about the karma of America.
Mm-hmm.
And so I had to write an essay for the Encyclopedia of American Philosophy on American identity. Well, half of it was about the genocide of Native people, misogyny, racism, incredible economic inequality. All right, all of those are characteristics of American place in the world. All right, and we also have these amazing documents that come from these six fabulous people that have inspired the world. And there are some efforts to offset the gross materialism by tolerance and human rights and et cetera, et cetera. It's a very uneven record. And I believe if we always say the shadow side with the positive side, I think it's okay. It's hard to be so unconsciously guilty of hubris when you're looking at the genocide of the Native Americans, the race, the slavery followed by racism, followed by horrific inequality of, and misogyny, it's all there. It's hard to be boastful. Just like, you know, so, you know, lots of men have built some things and they also have beaten their wives. And you have to have both on the page. That doesn't mean that evolution of consciousness is true. It is to say that if we talk about it, I think we have to talk about the shadow.
I agree.
The West has an incredible shadow, and it is very creative.
Sometimes I wonder if that creativity is sort of a front to keep the shadow going, but sort of a mechanism or a tool of the shadow. I wonder.
It's a good wonder. There are achievements. But if the shadow gets really overwhelming, then even the achievements are lost.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not disagreeing with you, honestly.
Yeah, no, I know.
It's a
situation.
Every one of these projects is very incomplete. Mm-hmm. And the evolution of consciousness is very incomplete. So I don't know where we are, and whether we're a third of the way through or half or whatever else. I hope we're not near the end because it's very unsatisfactory.
There's no way we're near the end. We're like not even to the beginning.
Okay.
I had an idea.
Okay.
It's a fantasy.
That's good.
A galactic
Sam,
example.
Yeah. I'll hold you, Brian, because Sam has the next shot. Sam?
I just kind of was wondering if I could make a comment based on what you said. It's interesting that
a little louder.
This idea of the evolution of consciousness and this whole hubristic, self-congratulatory, like, look at my idea that's been thrown out there without trying to negate or reject that, which also, you know, has a kind of hierarchical spin about it. You know, I'm actually gonna mention two white guys right now, I'm gonna name that, but, you know, Whitehead had, you know, that idea of, like, the fallacy of misplaced concreteness, where we get, where we make a theory for something that's an abstraction of what's actually going on, and then we think the theory is what it is. You know, that in some way that these narratives, these abstractions, these outlines of an evolution of consciousness, it's a theory, it's an abstraction that then gets mistaken for what's actually going on. So, oh yeah, we got it, we figured out this is what's going on. And yet we're making an abstraction of something that we allegedly are. You know, especially if Teilhard's actually right, if we are the universe reflecting on itself now, allegedly we're trying to abstract what we actually are, so we have to embody it and we have to be that. And so if the evolution of consciousness is characterized by greater differentiation that has to come back in unity or communion, what needs to be embodied is greater levels of communion, you know, in this, like, not, you know, one, you know, I mean, not these huge lists of just white guys who are building upon each other's theories, but a degree of greater levels of dialogue through that multiplicity of perspectives that may not even seem relevant to these abstract theories, but I think by embodiment that might actually apply to it. And I'm also one, you know, a white guy, like, saying an idea right now.
I think it was good that you went ahead with it. Right. And speaking of Whitehead, I think I think that Whitehead is almost certainly not guilty of hubris. I don't think there's a single biography of Whitehead, because there was no scandals. Whitehead was just a really, totally decent human being, right? He's a great husband, he was a great father, he was good to his friends, people admired him, he did his work, he wrote gorgeous books, were a little too hard sometimes, but they were beautiful. He was just a really fine human being. And so, if he didn't believe in the evolution of consciousness, I would not try to convince him. Not your Whitehead, what you think is really just really great. All right? And if he did believe in evolution of consciousness, I think he'd be the first one to say, but wait a minute, where is Thailand, and where is, you know, Egypt or whatever? He would see that. But that wasn't his task. He was really in modern Western and post-Western thought. My guess is that the people who are going to advance the content of the evolution of consciousness will do so against their will and against their paradigm, namely the historians and the anthropologists. They're gonna give us all the content so that in a generation or two, somebody's gonna say, I think I've got this, I think I've got a picture of this. I think I've got a gloss on it. I think I see where it's going. But right now, I don't think, we know too much to do it and we don't know enough to do it well. You know, I'm gonna hold you. Somebody else, was there not somebody? No?
Brian, I think.
Brian, I knew there was somebody.
So I have an issue with the hubris.
A little louder for me, Brian.
I have an issue with the hubris of the evolution of consciousness. I mean, not to take away, I mean, the problems. I mean, obviously there's people, you know, fighting tooth and nail against it for thousands of years, but.
Against the evolution of consciousness?
Of course, you know, like 2,000 years ago, and there was monarchs, there was kings who put themselves up, and they said that they were manifestations of God, and then everybody else was below them.
Right.
So to say that we haven't evolved consciousness since that time, it doesn't make sense to me.
No.
Because it obviously has.
Right.
150 years ago, we did have slaves in the United States of black people. Right now, we don't. We
right.
evolved. This isn't to say that, and then in the 60s, there's civil rights. So they got rid of the laws against black people voting. That doesn't mean that they're not trying to still do it again. It's a constant.
Of course.
But to say that there hasn't been an evolution of consciousness that's been progress, and to call that hubris, I just don't agree with that.
I think there's a confusion.
I think there has been an evolution of consciousness.
There has been.
And it's continuing.
Really? Brian, I've got to insist on making a correction.
Of course.
There's two different things. One is progress. The other one is evolution of consciousness. That's different. There have not been opposition to evolution of consciousness for 1,000 years. You can only be against evolution of consciousness for the last 100 or 150 years. Prior to that, you could be against progress of a certain kind. The question that doesn't answer is whether that piece of progress is part of a larger whole, or whether it is just what it is, a separate piece. Of course, everything progressive is opposed, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, is there a telos, is there a process that is coherent and that there is here. In the pages that I gave you, I said here. Did I not? Yeah. Evolution of consciousness refers to pressure from below, push from behind, striving within, lure from in front, influence from above, the teleological process of change. That's not just an individual piece of progress. You see what I'm saying? That's really crucial. Elizabeth, you see what I'm saying?
Yes, yeah, so I just think this might be a good time to address my earlier question. About,
did I miss a question?
About
world wars.
About the world wars. Like, cause
oh, yeah, yeah, right.
In the 1800s, everyone really did
That's,
believe in progress.
I didn't know what it meant. I put down world war. Okay, I'm going to answer it.
And like, so how do these severe regressions fit into the idea of evolution of consciousness?
Exactly. Case in point.
Cycles.
So, one of the really great philosophers of the early 20th century was Henri Bergson, who wrote in 1909 a great book called Creative Evolution. But we could easily have a seminar on creative evolution and just love it. Really great book. And he was a kind of a darling professor at the Sorbonne in Paris. He was a great lecturer, he was learned, he was eloquent. A very beautiful man, I mean, in every way. I mean, I wrote a master's thesis at Bergson. He's really a very, very wonderful man. All right. And when the war came in 2014, people thought, what was Bergson talking about with élan vital? The cream of European society just went about killing each other for 4 years. A whole generation of males was slaughtered on the fields of France. What élan vital is he talking about? So every time there is one of these sort of up against the possibility of progress, the evolution of consciousness suffers. When it looks like there's a breakthrough or something really good, you know, there's the Marshall Plan or something that people could actually be proud of, then people say, you know, we're really making progress. There's no more slavery. People admit that there shouldn't be economic inequality. There should be equality of gender, etc. Then they say, well, maybe this seems like there's overall there is this kind of thing happening. And then if it's like that, then your evolution of consciousness is in trouble. Because we're not talking about individual pieces. We're talking about, is there a pattern? Mm-hmm. Is it going somewhere for a reason? Okay. Make clear? Okay. The Second World War was a complete catastrophe for the evolution of consciousness because Germany was supposed to be a highly cultured civilization. Right? And they still say this. How did this happen? Well, Aurobindo and Teilhard, Steiner wasn't there for the Second World War. Aurobindo and Jung both say it happened because there are bad beings. And Jung says, as you know, that there's evil all the way up to the divine. All right. Yeah.
This is related to Elizabeth's comment and Sam's
proxy. Okay.
Is one thing that you might be interested in checking out, you may or may not, I'm just going to throw it out to the class, is Thomas Mann and Hermann Hesse.
Yeah.
Of course, two of like the greatest, you know, German intellectual writers at the time. Post-World War II really meditated on this question of what was the role of the creme de la creme German intelligentsia intellectual, you know, perfect culture in what eventually happened in World War II. And Thomas Mann wrote Dr. Faustus,
right.
You know, and Hermann Hesse wrote The Glass Bead Game.
Right.
And both of them, if they're related, even though they're very different stories, are about a lack of integration of ideas within embodiment, you know, a lack of connection between abstract ideas and as things are being lived, you know. And one thing that I just really think about a lot, you know, just studying, you know, the different traditions of the West in general is, you know, in India, you know, it's often said that how do you recognize a guru when everybody's saying different things? Is you can only really recognize the truth of an idea. And this is totally counter to the Western idea, is you recognize the guru by his or her conduct. You know, and if there is a mismatch between the conduct and the idea, then that means it's not being embodied. You know, and...
Well, why do you think that's contrary in the West?
Well, because there's the, you know, there's a much more idea here of like, well, that person wasn't perfect, but this idea has value independent of their character. I mean, I would say that that's kind of the large, you know, the understanding. You know, maybe I'm wrong there, but maybe you guys disagree with me. But there seems to be an idea in the West that this person was terrible in their personal lives. But these ideas really pushed forward the history of ideas. You know, this was a jump forward, you know, where that is really just not the case. When
I have an idea that I'd like you to consider.
Okay.
I don't know if I'm speaking for the West, but I'm speaking definitely for myself.
Right.
A strong conviction that I have.
Thomas
Jefferson. I'm often asked this question about, does it matter to you that somebody you're lecturing on has questionable moral life, okay? And my answer is, if the person is doing science or art, Wagner or anyone like that, it doesn't matter that much, and maybe not at all. But if a person that we're talking about, I'm lecturing on, I'm writing about, is teaching from his or her experience, then the fault is crucial. So, there's an interesting case is Heidegger, right?
Yeah, right.
So,
I was gonna bring him up.
Right. Immediately, right? The best case. And some of my friends and I really disagree about Heidegger. I have
Of conversations between Martin Luther King versus Malcolm X and how they behaved in their personal lives opposed to each other. you know, one of the most famous moments of the FBI tapes of them, you know, tapping Malcolm X's phone as he's on the phone with his wife and they're having this loving conversation. And then clearly overheard is an FBI agent saying, man, compared to King, this guy's a monk.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Malcolm X.
We're in the thick here.
Yeah, but this is it.
Okay. I'm going to hold to my principle. I'm going to hold you for a minute because this is really. I have noticed that this is important to some people. I have noticed that over time. So I'm going to try to be helpful. All right? I'm not saying that I know this is true what I'm saying, but I have thought about it sufficiently that I'd like to get it out. Okay. That Martin Luther King, about whom I know a lot, including the Hoover tapes, etc., was not teaching about gender. He was teaching about race and Let me go on a little further. So it makes a difference how close the failing is to the person's importance.
Mm.
All right? So if the Dalai Lama now turns out to be a really seriously flawed person, that seriously hurts his mission as a teacher of compassion. All right? But if the head of a state who is not a spiritual teacher, all right, whoever you want to name, since it's easy to name dozens of people in 10 seconds, that seems to me rather unimportant. The idea and the creation, all right, can still be, I think, undiminished by their personal lives if they're not teaching out of their personal lives. So Gandhi had pretty unconscious in areas where he should have been conscious. Martin Luther King was unconscious in areas where he should have been conscious. To some extent, they are examples of morality and courage and et cetera. To some extent, that's actually not what they're teaching. They're teaching racial justice, or they're teaching economic justice, all right, for which their personal behavior is not crucial. It would be helpful. And I'm disappointed that they risked their worldwide importance by behavior that was, from almost anybody's point of view, not a good idea, all right? But I think we want to figure out when the person's creativity and creative work is sufficiently removed from their faults that we can go with the work and not be impeded by the faults. And I don't know if that's helpful, but Elizabeth.
So basically I'm hearing that like hypocrisy is what really matters. And like it's possible to be immoral in a lot of ways without being a hypocrite. But if you are teaching something specific and you're not living it, that's when you become
exactly.
And that's what you're saying,
right?
Really matters.
Yeah, I don't mind if a person is hypocritical. I do mind. But I'm not talking about someone who's hypocritical in an area that has nothing to do with their importance.
Exactly, yeah.
Right. So if they're preaching sophisticated gender ideas and behavior, and in the meantime, they have their behavior is the opposite, that I think they've dishonored themselves and their teaching. Right, then why go to that person for that teaching when surely we can find somebody else? Which is what I say to the people who read Heidegger. Why would you go to Heidegger when his philosophy is definitely affected by his political position and vice versa? Why? When you can read Dewey or Whitehead.
What does Aaron Weiss say about that? Because he's obviously the resident Heideggerian.
I haven't discussed it with Aaron Weiss.
Okay.
Oh, Aaron Weiss, I'm saying yeah. Eric Weiss. Aaron reads Heidegger. We disagree.
Okay, but what, so can you give us his position so we get the
maybe not.
Okay.
But he said, yeah, I hear you. I grant it's a problem. I think Heidegger's worth reading. And I have a lot of friends who think that. When I was in New York, it was really intense. I mean, every year I hired faculty from the part-time faculty from the New School, which was a center of Heideggerian studies, and yeah, it was intense. There were 8 members of our faculty and 4 were Jewish. It was quite a lot of and the 2 most senior Jewish faculty disagreed. One wrote a book on Heidegger. Very complicated, I know. But I know what I think. It may not be the best thing to think, but at least I've sorted it out for what it's worth. I'm checking your time. I want to see if some people haven't spoken. Kai, were you going to say something before? I saw your hand, or almost a hand. It was sort of a couple inches off the table.
I mean, you know,
which isn't
all of what we're talking about is terribly important. I was just interested in the Atlanteans. So, like, when I think about that, I'm like, well, geez, that's just kind of like a fun mind candy.
I want to hear a story about
it. So, I have a lot of friends. So
what I'm feeling, though, is like, okay, when I reflect on the last 100 years, the evolution of consciousness, I'm like, oh, yeah, of course we're evolving. And then, given this larger discussion, I'm like, wait, actually, we very well just may not, like, or what direction. Yeah. So there's a whole level of just, what's the word, reconsideration happening.
Say that last part.
Reconsideration, evaluation.
Yeah. This is, I mean, I wouldn't have brought you together for 3 hours to talk about something that was simple and easy and obvious. This is hard stuff. Lots of really smart, well-informed people disagree about this. Very, not just because of the hubris question, but because the evidence is so flimsy.
Well, then let's, like, if we go back to Coming Home, which, like, Sean Kelly obviously really takes seriously the shadow sides,
right,
and is really, like, concerned about that. We can see him embodying that. It's maybe very helpful, then, his metaphor I just want to share with you guys, because it does take account for the regression, and it's these cycles that loop back on themselves, while nonetheless, in the way he traces it, would then be really useful for this conversation.
Right. Sean is a Hegelian, Jungian, and he's comfortable with meta-narrative, and he thinks the economy's going down, and maybe the whole capitalist civilization will go down, but he still thinks that that will be a positive and something will come out of it. Yes, Soleil.
I'm just noticing a pattern within the conversation of individuals and their morality, and then the shadow side of evolution of consciousness itself, and who's talking about it. That within evolution is this necessity of shadow. That to evolve, the shadow has to come out.
Exactly.
And
that's
so,
what we learned from Jung.
Yeah. And that, so within creativity, we have to be able to face the shadow. Nothing is going to be able to change that can just be a happy.
This is, Elizabeth wrote about Answer to Job and had some really good passages, which Jung says almost exactly what you said, that, why are you surprised? Where have you been? Of course there's going to be a shadow, and then maybe some people, or maybe those people's children or next generation will say, did you not see that? Do you know how many African-American males from 18 to 25 are in jail? You didn't see that? Okay, we can't have that, so then we'll pay attention. So it's always, the shadow is an absolute necessary ingredient to progress. Steiner does it in terms of tempters. The one tempter says, oh, everything's great, nothing to worry about, you're all enlightened, you're all spiritual, and we're all privileged because we're, you know, so wonderful we're here. And the other one is, don't worry, because there's basically nothing, there's no spirit anyway. So just basically get the money, basically money, sex, and power, and, you know, that's all you really need. And that's all there is. Okay. So then he says, how do we hold that balance? So yes, the shadow is important. It's essential even. And I don't know any big thinkers who don't have that. Aurobindo has them, has these apsaras who are tempters and who steal and cheat and do terrible things. And I mean, Jesus was only baptized a few hours when he was eyeball to eyeball with the devil. Yeah, yeah, and the devil, go to that passage, you'll see it. The devil says, this, I'll give you this kingdom. So he had the kingdom to give. I'll give you this kingdom. All you have to do is worship me. The devil was way up there. Absolutely. And the devil says, get over here. I want to talk to you. Now that you've been baptized, we are basically having it out for the next 3 years, however long it takes. I'm looking for people who have spoken least. We're running out of those people. Oh, yeah, good.
I just wanted your opinion on, like, if suppose evolution of consciousness is true, what would the consensus, like, what is it leading towards? What would our society, politics, economics look like if we were to move to a next phase?
Yeah. The really good question.
Atlantis.
Atlantis.
And the movie starts over.
Didn't they blow themselves up?
See, I think that one of the really positive things that's very distinctive about America is multi-pluralism, multiculturalism, multiracial, everything multi. It is, I think, the most important experiment in the world. There are more, almost every country you name has almost as many people, except China and India, almost as many people of that ethnicity in the United States as in the home country, right? So how's this? In Los Angeles, the first grade of certain school districts have as their, have 100 different primary languages.
Wow.
All right. That is true of all of the major cities, all right? In New York is just incredible. There are at least 40 or 50 major communities of cultures from far away. That is an enormous experiment in coherence. So the countries that are extremely intolerant of America's intolerance have not even begun to deal with our pluralism.
Yeah.
What we're dealing with is very, very hard and very important. We could be the first culture to break through the culture barrier. So one of the things that Steiner says is that, and it's true of this, of our culture right here, our little culture, subculture, is that in the future, identity will not be by blood. It will be by values. So many people in this school and have as their primary family, the family that they made here among friends, and not the family of origin. It's quite common. So that is a new development, and it's very American. The mobility is very distinctively American, and the pluralism. Every time I go back to New York, I realize it's just the ethnicity here is fabulous, and that's a different ethnicity. It's just like 12 different Latin American cultures, and the Cubans and the Puerto Ricans, like that. And it's really intense. And they're also riding the same train. Now, the train did more to undo caste in India than anything else, more than Gandhi. Because people of the different castes got pushed together, and they had to ride in the same train. So there's lots of these things, and media is doing that too. But America is amazing for that. So I think what's going to happen is that in the future, people will be grouped and will group themselves by values more than by blood. The blood thing that happened in the Second World War was so clearly false and crazy. It couldn't possibly be a good idea for the future. Couldn't be. Okay, out of time. Thanks for your conversation, your questions, discussions, everything is good. And next time is the 25th. That means it is Corinne Donnelly, who did our master's program, and Sean says she's a terrific writing teacher. So, and he gave a 2-period, so I'm giving a 2-period. I think it'll be good. And if you send me anything, subject line, intro. and I will never lose you again. Thank you for that, Donald. It's gonna work.
Good. But, is that it? Nice, really good.
You sent me two pages.
Zero's the right.
Exactly.
This is part of my integration.
If you didn't get it back, I didn't read it. As soon as I read it, I send it back.
I mean, it's not.
So send it to me again.
See you tomorrow.
But you see, I went looking for all the papers.